There's no original ideas in the world, Elaine. Nothing ever is original. Nothing's original. They're making the Mean Girls and the Legally Blondes and the musicals, and that was my idea first.
Oh,
I mean, my idea first to turn it into a musical. They already made the movie. That wasn't me. So I'm sitting here and I say, what's a Broadway producer, which is what I am, what is a Broadway producer to do in this modern day where nothing is original and everything's recycled? And I was thinking to myself, what if we went for Wonka again? Try number three. There was like a weird one back in the 1970s, and then like we did another one recently, and that's had like 8 different versions, but what if we did it again? And I know the prequel's coming out, but what if we did it again? But this time, we get rid of all the songs that everybody loved and take weird songs that no one wanted and put them in there. What if we did that? And, like, that kind of don't really make sense for the story because the person who came up with the jukebox playlist kind of kept forgetting that she wasn't making a soundtrack and was actually making a jukebox musical. So sometimes it's just more of a tone piece, you know what I mean? It's not really lyrically accurate.
It's more highbrow media. Highbrow.
Yeah. It's a bit of... It's very experimental. A tone piece. Ooh. A dream ballet. Think of Philip Glass opera. You know the ones that are like 8 hours and you... Just think about that. An 8-hour Wonka. A real-time Wonka.
Wow.
For the factory. In real time. It's like that fucking thing in New York with the Macbeth. Where you're all in the big building and everybody wears the masks and they've got like, and everybody's all creepy and a bunch of people are dying and I think there's wine. I think it's called Sleep No More. That, but with Wonka. Actually, that's a good idea. Yeah. And you get to walk through the factory IRL. That actually sounds sick as hell. Fuck. I just dropped my fake straw cigarette, which I think means the bit is over. I think that's a signal
for
the
universe. Who does the Broadway producer pitch to?
You apparently no.
Okay, hold on. Wait, let me smoke my chapstick. Well, kid, I've heard it all, but I ain't never heard of a third Wonka musical. It's so crazy. It might just work. Here, take my $5. Get yourself something from McDonald's and start brainstorming and send me your best work, and I'll go through your portfolio. And we'll see if you got the stuff, kid.
You've got it, boss.
What a great intro. That sounded like a video game cutscene. There was
never
like
felt more empowered in a bit with you. I felt like we were Broadway.
We're actually the spirit of Broadway.
It's like those fundraisers. It's like, but the true spirit of Broadway is Elaine Best and Felicia.
They've been hiding away in all these years, but we finally found them.
They do that thing where they do like a tribute night to us, but like, you know, we're like 27 and 18 just sitting in the audience being like, yeah. And they're like, and this one goes out to Felicia and it goes like this. Succession, 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 succession.
Oh my God, like, how did they know?
Yeah, they know. And then they're like, Elaine, this one's for you. And it's just like, a monkey comes on stage and starts screaming and throws a banana in my face. And I go, shit.
And then one woman just goes, have you ever heard of a woman named Anastasia Romanoff? And then you say,
and they're literally like, well, we brought her here tonight, ladies and gentlemen, the Grand Duchess.
Tell the people, what are we doing here today, Felicia?
So today's episode, it's kind of a weird one, which I think I say literally every episode.
It's
at
kind
this
of
point.
A weird one, Wonka Watch.
Literally, at this point. I feel like, you know what I realized? We never introduce ourselves on the podcast. We never say who we are.
I was thinking about this too. I was like, if someone just started with this episode, they have no idea what the flying fuck is going on. Should we do a really quick 30-second spiel?
Oh my God. So Wonka Watch is a podcast from two people who didn't think they cared about the Wonkaverse until the prequel was announced. And then we were like, oh shit, maybe we do care about this incredibly deeply and passionately. And until the movie releases at the very least, we will be diving headfirst into the Wonkaverse, uncovering every little rock and putting our own rocks that weren't even there into it. And using what we learned to make assumptions about the movie coming out in December of 2023,
which we refer to as the Wonka Rapture.
Yes. So I'm Felicia.
I don't think I've ever said those words on this podcast. Oh, man. I don't think I've ever introduced myself on this podcast.
Let me, like, I am Elaine. You're right.
I am Elaine. And you're Felicia. And credits are fucking podcast.
This turns into our live coaching session.
But this episode is one that I added to our insane, like, topic dump board a while ago and then, like, didn't really think of the ramifications of what that would be, which was called Willy Wonka Jukebox Musical. So that's what's happening today. I have, from the deep annals of my music collection, picked out a few classy little tunes and numbers that just fit in the story to me. We're doing Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. We're going classic. We're not getting crazy with it. I could try and do the movie, but I figured that would do too much speculation, and I thought keeping it easy and simple was fun. Elaine says, will you pick songs that other people will recognize? And I said, I literally don't know how to do that. Not in a pretentious way. I just genuinely don't know how to do it. So we're going to get a little weird with some of the choices here. I also, like, kind of accidentally kind of forgot what a jukebox musical is and forgot that the characters would have to sing the songs, I guess, if that makes sense. So I was kind of thinking about a half soundtrack. So some of these picks are a little strange. And if you picture the characters singing them, don't really work. But that's okay. We're going to work with it. And I think that's part of the fun.
Yeah, it's a draft, and we're going through together.
A rough draft. But before we dive deep into my lovely little playlist I've made, Wonka Watch?
I don't know. Yeah, okay.
Okay. Today's Wonka Watch. Wonka Watch is our little segment of the pod where we dive into anything new in the world of Wonka that's happened over the last few weeks. Isn't this crazy? I'm actually describing what things are.
It just feels so weird.
It's so fucking weird.
It's so weird.
I've never, like, had to say what Wonka Watch is. We just kind of assume everybody's on board. You know, it's weird not to be talking about things in well metaphors and just talking about them like a normal person.
If they go, Adam Driver Centaur, what the flying fuck are you even talking about? You know,
I mean, we're not going to explain everything, but
oh no, you in due time.
My piece I'm bringing to the table is Mr. Beast is making Willy Wonka's factory. So, do you know about Mr. Beast, Elaine?
Is he the YouTuber that's constantly giving away, like, million-dollar prizes for people doing silly challenges? He has a mustache.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
It's an interesting mustache. He, I don't think I've ever watched one of his videos willingly. So that's, like, to just know where we're coming from. Like, we don't really know much about him. I think I skimmed through the Squid Game one and was like, this is exhausting to watch. But he made a, I got this article from ladbible.com because of course I did.
Wow.
Mr. Beast shares his sneak peek inside his Willy Wonka chocolate factory. And here's the thing that I don't like about Mr. Beast. I appreciate that he will, like, try and build this whole chocolate factory, but I know he's not even going to wear a costume. He's just going to wear that stupid fucking hoodie that he's always wearing and, like, a baseball hat. Yeah. And I'm like, at least give us some fucking whimsy. Okay. You know what I mean? Yeah. But last year, the 24-year-old whose real name is Jimmy Donaldson.
He's 24 years old.
Also, his name is Jimmy Donaldson, which is very funny. Built a real-life Squid Game set where contestants would undergo various non-life-threatening challenges. While we don't know Mr. Beast's plan for the Willy Wonka-themed set, he tweeted a sneak peek to his followers to give us all a glimpse of the early stages. His tweet says, "We're in the early stages of recreating Willy Wonka's chocolate factory. This photo is like 10% of it. Why didn't somebody tell me this would be so hard?" Literally anyone could have told you that. Number one, why weren't we brought on to consult? Major question.
I don't know. Yeah.
We've written a whole reality show. If any of those challenges are close to our Willy Wonka, our Wonka Mania game show we made, I'm suing. That's not true.
You'll hear from our lawyers.
But I'm going to drop a photo that he gave as the example into our drop zone over here. And it's a look, I applaud the man for wanting
work
to make
progress.
A chocolate factory. Wow. However, I think he's going for a more 2005 Willy Wonka, obviously, which I guess makes sense for his age. But if you're going to make a chocolate room, don't make that one. Why would you make that one? It's like the ugliest chocolate room by a large margin. It doesn't look good. I'm not going to lie. I think it looks bad.
They definitely just put down the fake grass or the sod, whatever, and there's like dirt path. I see where it's going. I definitely think this entire room will be transformed. You know what it is, Felicia? This is the thing we were talking about on like last episode and like this entire podcast. It's like anybody else who does a Wonka thing, we just get twitchy about.
Yeah, no, we do a little bit.
I'm kind of twitchy right now.
Yeah, I do think the color palette of this is bad. Like, you could have, like, at least made it a little bit more whimsical. So, like, pushed the greens of the grass a little bit more bluish. So they still would have a green tone.
It should not look like actual grass.
No, this looks this is like a fantasy. This literally looks like just like a hill in a park that a weird plastic lollipop is stuck into.
Yeah, this is like mini golf right now.
It also, yes, it's giving mini golf. That's what it's giving.
Mini golf vibes.
It's mini golf. You're so right.
Now, Willy Wonka mini golf. Yes.
Oh my god, that sounds incredible. This would be great for a mini golf course, but if you're trying to recreate Wonka's factory. No.
What? I saw there's a fountain, but I thought it was a well. I'm the short red one. I about lost my fucking shit. I was about to be subtweeting Mr. Beast. I haven't been on Twitter in ages, so I was about to dust off that profile and be like, a well. Sorry, it's just a fountain, guys. False alarm. Wonka Watch officially has confirmed there is no well in Mr. Beast's chocolate factory.
We better be. And if Mr. Beast, if you for some reason are listening to this, any critiques I have are absolutely null and void if you invite me. Absolutely null and void. I think this is the best thing ever made on the entire
planet. You've understood. Like, we're in this too deep.
And I also as someone who wanted to be a set designer for a really long time, this kind of pains me a little bit. Why is it so neutral? The color choices are so neutral. Those rocks should be at least a little bit like, why is everything in the neutral category? We need to be bringing out some colors, at least be a chromatic gray, not this neutral. Anyway, that's not the point. He's also working on making a chocolate waterfall, and he has posted a video of this in progress, so I'm gonna throw the tweet in here. This has 3.3 million views,
and you know like, I mean, this is like on a phone, but I feel like on camera chocolate river,
it's a little bit too orangey.
It's too liquidy. Also, I feel like a chocolate river should be a little thicker, and I think that's been my issue,
like diarrhea.
This is a post chipotle extra spicy salsa moment.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry I said that, and I can't stop looking
at it. No, I agree with you. While he's doing all this, he's kind of distracted because he's also, for some fucking reason, terraforming an island. And I don't know why he's terraforming an island. Apparently, he's giving away an island. Not related to the Wonka thing. This is just a side project for him. So there's a quote from him, and he said, "And while building this, we also have to terraform an island. I'm giving an island away for $100 million, but nice looking big islands cost $20 million. So I bought an ugly big island, and we've been importing sand and hundreds of trees and building a lake, etc., to not make it ugly. LOL." It's just weird. Like, what are we doing? Mr. Like, Beast makes me feel like really makes me reflect on the world we live in. And there's nothing he's doing that's especially horrible. It just makes me feel icky, and I don't know why.
Yeah, I guess I don't get it.
I don't get it,
like,
either.
The whole entire aesthetic. But it's not made for me.
It's not made
for
us.
Like, we're not the audience.
Even though it should be, because it's a fucking Wonka factory. But, you know, it's fine.
It's sad. I know it'll look better when it's done, but still, this is not... I don't know, though.
His Squid Game one didn't look that good, in my opinion. It was, like, okay.
That's a bummer.
He didn't invest in interesting enough lighting, and that's my concern. If you keep the warehouse lighting, it doesn't work.
Damn.
The problem is it's also shot like a YouTube video, so all the things in movies that they do to hide the fact that they're in like a set, they don't do on the Mr. Beast video. So I don't think it's gonna look that different, unfortunately.
Ah, bummer.
All right. Oh, but what's this? Another newspaper has been slidden under my door? That's not a word. What's on the headlines? Read it out to me, Elaine. I don't have my glasses on.
Ladies and gentlemen of Grosvenor Square, it is I, Lady Whistledown, here with your Wonka secret.
Okay, y'all, here's what happened. I was curious because sometimes I think about the mourner. And if you don't remember this, and it was like our second episode, we're going through what we know about the movie and we're looking at the cast. And for some reason, in the top 10 main people in the cast, there was this random guy who's the mourner. No information. Alfredo Tavare. No one knows who he is. Alfredo Tavare, our favorite. And I was just like, I wonder if he's still up there. And I went to look and he's not. But we had someone else there and we have a character name that kind of suggests a lot, in my opinion. There's a lot to read here. So Freya Parker, who you may know from the new Jurassic movie, will be in this movie playing as Miss Bonbon.
Wow.
what the fuck does that mean? Miss Bonbon, clearly candy related.
Yeah.
And that kind of changes a lot of the, like, you know, as Olivia Colman, the person who is helping him. And now I'm getting more evil vibes from her because Miss Bonbon seems like she would be nice. Unless Miss Bonbon is like a candy, like,
you know what? It also goes back to that. Like, I don't think this is definitely not what's happening in the movie. But do you remember in like early episodes, we had this bit about Wonka being in a cabaret and how he made money on the side as a burlesque dancer. And you said, and they called him Candy. Miss Bonbon could be like,
wow,
the leader of that house. Now, is that what's happening? I'm sure it's not. However, if that was somehow what this movie was, what a great call.
What a great call. She works the saloon. And
yes, that's Willy what I'm wondering. The question is this a name of someone who is involved with chocolate, or is the world so whimsical that that's just her name?
Wow. Because I could see Paul King doing that. I could like just see that being like a hilarious thing. I'm going to read into it that this is a crucial character role. I don't know how prominent in the movie Miss Bonbon will be, but it just feel, I don't, there was just a chill that went down my spine when I saw the name Miss Bonbon. And I was like, shit. Another reminder that this movie is actually real and happening.
Yeah. Well, I think we have some good stuff for our predictions at the end of the episode. We're going to be focused on Miss Bonbon.
I'm going to put that in the crock pot and let it slow cook until the end here, guys.
Yeah. I also started adding themes to our predictions so that I can see how accurate we are by themes. Oh, so I can see like also how many predictions we've made about Wonka himself, how many of our predictions directly contradict each other, how many predictions about Hugo Loompa, how many are about animals, how many are about strange props that Wonka will grab, how many are about genius, like larger references. It's scary, but it's also fun. I just love data so much.
You love
so
data.
But all right, Elaine, I think it's time for you to see the previews of my beautiful new musical, sung for you by a wide variety of people. And we're, in this story, we're following the story of Willy Wonka, but we push the boundaries a little bit. We cover some things that are implied, but we don't really get to see until you watch this musical.
You gotta infer, you gotta infer, you gotta understand. Paint me the picture with your beautiful paintbrushes. Yeah. I'm the open canvas, I'm ready.
So, there may or may not be a link to this playlist in the description, because I don't really want to put my personal Spotify out there, because I think that's a little incriminating about facts about me and my life.
too much
I want to be accessible. So if we decide to make a Wonka Watch Spotify account, that will be in the description, and if not, make it yourself. But yeah, I've made a selection of 13 songs for the Wonka musical. I guess we just got to start right into it. And to start off this Wonka musical, I wanted to kind of take a step back. We're starting pre-Charlie, because Charlie is very boring. And I tried to fix that with my version. So what I've done right here is I've created for, I wanted to kind of start the musical with Wonka inventing some weird things, just like making up weird shit. And for that, I've chosen the all-time classic Weird Science by Oingo Boingo. And, you know, I think this, I knew I had to fit some Oingo Boingo in here because Danny Elfman is like a registered part of the Wonkaverse, and he's the Oingo Boingo guy. He voiced all the Oompa Loompas in the 2005 one. So I was like, you know what? Let's have a nod. And Weird Science, it's kind of too perfect of a song. There were about 8 Oingo Boingo songs in my first draft, so I had to cut that down a considerable degree. You know, there's lots of fun little lyrics in here. I've pulled out, you know, the refrain of the song is from my heart into my hand and from my hands. Why don't people understand my intentions? Feels very Wonka. Do you know what I mean? It's very overdramatic. Yeah. We have plastic tubes and pots and pans, bits and pieces and magic from the hand, you know?
Wow. Okay. Okay.
So do you know this? Are you familiar with Weird Science? Or the works of
I will know 2 of your songs. So I think what I'm going to do is what's the name of that show James A. Castor does with his friend where he describes what the chocolate tastes like and stuff?
Just Desserts.
We're going to do Just Music, where I will interpret what this song sounds like to other people.
I will play a brief clip of it, but yeah. Elaine's eyes are just slowly getting wider.
if a jazz band fell down two flights of stairs, but we're still happy about it. That's what that song is. Very fitting.
Elaine, if that's your reaction to that song, I'm worried about you as this playlist continues, because that's like the most milquetoast song on here.
Well, this is going to be fun, isn't it?
I'm going to be honest, guys. As much as a lot of these choices are motivated by what I think would work for Wonka, a lot of this is also Elaine has to listen to these songs. And I'm just kind of having fun with that. You know, I don't want it to come off of like, my music taste is so weird and I'm so cool for it. That's truly not what it is. I just ended up in a weird part of music when I was 14 and I've never really gotten out of it. Next song, I wanted to have more of an inclusion of the chocolate spies in this version. And for that, I've gone to my old faithful, my bisexual awakening, the one and only Kate Bush, my love. I couldn't have made this without putting Kate Bush in some capacity. It wouldn't have felt untrue to myself. This is very much like a Wonka Jukebox musical, strictly through the eyes of Felicia. Like, I don't think this is like a universal Jukebox musical. This is like me only. Not me only, but like for a very specific audience, which is me.
It's very Wonka of you.
Yeah, to demand my opinions and that everyone listen to them. So this song, Kate Bush writes a lot from the perspective of characters. And this song is from the perspective of a person who's super paranoid of being poisoned. Like, just so paranoid about it. And the whole song is just like, offer me a chocolate. No. Why does the chocolate smell like almonds? That's a no-no to your coffee. You know, it's great. You know, great music. That stuff. She also sings about have the walls got ears here. And the main reason I picked this was because there's kind of this overwhelming paranoia. There's this like fear being poisoned. Mm. And she also talks in German at the end of the song, which reminded me of Wonka. Because like Wonka talks in German for no reason, especially in 1970s. So like, you know, perfect.
If a cabaret had more of a polka vibe and if a bottle of syrup got to sing.
Yes, that's very like. Kate Bush, actually.
I've like never experienced this before. Why am I? This is going weirdly well so far, Felicia. And this is Thank no you. Diss to you. I really wasn't sure what to expect.
Yeah.
I'm still a little scared. We're only two songs in, but I'm.
Yeah. So after the chocolate spies happen, Wonka's like, oh my God, I need to be alone in this world. Everybody hates me and nobody likes my chocolate the way they used to and everyone wants to steal my ideas. And for this song, I think Wonka's singing about how to be alone. There is not a better song than Excuse Me by Peter Gabriel. This song is all about wanting to be alone and how he's not the man he used to be and all this kind of stuff. But it's also the goofiest song. It's got cartoon sound effects. It sounds like it's from like somebody farted in Toontown and then this song happened.
Oh, Lord.
It starts with a barbershop choir. So you're going to need to skip 45 seconds in to get past that because that's when it really hits. So just know that it starts with a barbershop choir and go 45 seconds in and you will understand completely why I picked this
okay.
song.
Okay. Here we go.
Excuse me, please. I'm looking for last days.
This is Jack Skeleton and Christian Wonka walking hand in hand. And they're, it's still happy with that like edge of like unsettling.
Exactly.
Okay.
There's a banjo inclusion.
Christian Wonka is at the saloon and they're playing on that piano. I started headbanging to that one, guys. That was insane.
Yeah, you started breaking out the hard seltzer when the song came on.
I noticed. Was like, here we go, Truly's classic lime margarita style.
Would not recommend.
Peter Gabriel's 1977 classic, Excuse Me, off of Peter Gabriel 1 Car, which is a very funny album name.
What the fuck? And the album cover is indeed just a car. Oh no, he's in it. I didn't even realize that. It's a car.
Is he? Oh shit. Yeah.
You see that? He's like asleep in
Wait,
a ghost.
Elaine, go to his profile on Spotify and look at the album cover for Us. Why is he He's just standing with his arms extended. Oh, it's very funny.
Oh my God. And it's like a woman and a tornado and
literally
a
torpedo woman.
That what are these bottle album body covers? What the?
They're a little
Peter
scary.
Gabriel 4? What the shit is going on?
So you see what's coming up next. You see what's coming up next. I'm guessing you might be a little familiar with this song.
Just a little bit.
So what I'd like you all to picture is we go to the Bucket family home. They're all sitting around the bed where the grandparents sleep. Charlie says, "Grandpa Joe, you know, don't you think maybe one day you'll get out of bed and come and help out the family?" And Grandpa Joe, you hear the piano start turning in. And what starts playing? But "I'd Do Anything for Love, But I Won't Do That" by Meatloaf. I don't think I need to explain this choice. I think this choice is very clear. Oh, no, it's a fantastic song. It's 11 minutes long also. So Grandpa Joe does get a 12-minute number. Potentially, we'd use a cut version of "I'd Do Anything for Love." I always forget it's that long. Also, this also has the album named Bad Out of Hell, too. Back into Hell, which is very funny.
The first way I learned about this song was a classic and famous Chips Ahoy commercial. Do you know this commercial?
No.
Oh, Lordy. This is going to be worth a YouTube watch. The chip was like claymation. If you want my body, then I... Okay, never mind. It was the wrong one. But these old commercials...
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, if you want my body and you think I'm sexy, hold on. You should go to the one that says Chips Ahoy date commercial.
Okay.
I'm thinking of the M&M's one. Like, that cookie says he's sexy.
I feel like I'm going to have a reaction. Is this how you felt when you watched the Alice video? Because I fucking hated that. So here's a fun fact about me. I'm actually scared of claymation, but not in the way Elaine is. So Elaine is scared of, like, you know, normal stop motion to be scared of, like that creepy taxidermy rabbit I showed her. No, I'm scared of Wallace and Gromit, you know, a normal measured thing to be scared of. They've always terrified me. They freaked me the hell out. And this activated that response in me. Meanwhile, I love Pingu. I'm a mystery. I don't understand myself sometimes. That was fucking terrifying. Why did you show that to me? Why does she look like that?
This giant cookie, Chips Ahoy cookie, is on a date with this blonde woman. And he's putting the moves and he's singing the song, "If you want my body and you think I'm sexy," which is exactly what that chocolate chip cookie says. As you can imagine, and I was young when this came out. Maybe the terrifying cookie can star as Augustus Gloop in the musical. I don't know.
I fucking hated that.
Great. I feel so validated that I was able to do that as a person on this podcast. So I love that "I'd Do Anything for Love."
Yeah, it's an elaborate
but
joke.
But I won't do that.
I'm also very much picturing the 1970s Wonka people for all of this. I don't know why. That's what's coming to my head. So
working.
that's the one where I like Grandpa Joe the least. So I want to give him that not terrible song, just like incriminating song, I guess. So I wanted to put a song that's kind of more about Wonka mania. So this is Wonka has announced the chocolate bar race and everyone's buying all the things. And I've picked "Call This Number Now" by The Garden, which I'm like iffy on The Garden. I can't decide if I actually like them or not, but this song I do like, and it's always given me like sleazy telephone salesperson vibes. So it works. Do the lyrics fit? Absolutely fucking not. But we are talking exclusively about vibes here. This is kind of more of a soundtrack piece. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Does that make
any
sense?
Well, maybe you can also, like, for the musical, you can probably change some of the words, but
exactly.
Just like the homage to the song. I've never heard of a song described as sleazy salesperson.
They yell a lot in this song. The lyrics are literally nothing. They don't mean anything.
It really is like one of those songs that talks like this. Okay, the jazz band has now gotten up from the flight of stairs they fell down.
Down the stairs.
And the bellboy apparently, the bellhop apparently has like a good voice. And he's like, "I'm going to sing now." The notes shouldn't work together musically, sonically.
Yeah.
I get the tone and how that could fit in here. And why it would be Wonka mania.
But you see why I mean? It's a little bit more of a tone and a soundtrack than it is a singing.
Yes. So it could be like the over, like you're watching everybody do all the running.
Yes, it's more of a soundtrack to the moment.
I do feel 5 points higher
on my manic scale.
I'm sorry.
2 point. No, it's anything can unlock it. We're all good. Me being on this podcast is always like a match next to some gasoline. Like, is it going to unlock it? Is the energy going to do it today? Is she going to feel immense energy and mild anxiety, but also like every creative idea is amazing at the same time?
Yeah. So I feel good about this choice. And this is, I think, one of my most, I'm very proud of this choice. And this is a song Elaine knows. She looks very excited in the camera. She's got her mouth open like a little hamster. And I have picked Mamma Mia by ABBA for here. And I wanted to solve the problem of Charlie having boring fucking songs. So he sings Mamma Mia about his reliance on the Wonka bars. And let's look at these lyrics because it really fits. I've been cheated by you since I don't know when. So I made up my mind. It must come to an end. Look at me now. Will I ever learn? I don't know how. But I'll suddenly lose control.
Lose control.
But there's a fire within my soul. And then he goes and he's like, I'm over it. I'm over it. And then he finds a quarter in the drain. Mamma Mia, here I go again. My, how can I resist you? Does it show again how much I've missed you? It's perfect. It's my masterpiece. I've painted this perfect picture with a little dab of ABBA, a dabba, if you will, under the painting that is this Wonka Jukebox musical.
I am manic, so I am like crying right now. That it's so funny, and I mostly I've never cried out of shock, but I am crying out of shock at how well
ABBA shouldn't fit that well.
I guess fit into any Jukebox musical, which, yeah, to be fair, I love ABBA. I have feelings about Mamma Mia, the musical.
I haven't seen it. I really should watch it. But I think it's because ABBA makes music that is just vague enough that you can twist it to fit anything you want. And that's not a diss to ABBA. I fucking love ABBA. That's where ABBA. Me and Elaine's music taste crawls over. It's ABBA and Glen Campbell. That's crossover.
I am going to still play this.
Yeah, because it's Mamma Mia, the best song on the planet.
Oh, the beginning of dun 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 dun. Oh, and then the guitar comes in and you're like, buana na na, buana na na na, buana na na, buana na na. I was cheated by you and I think I know it.
So I don't even need to put in the little clip of the music because I think Elaine did it for me.
I made up my mind. It must come to an end.
It would be so good.
Look at me now. I'm gonna skip to this is just for me right now. Done boy looking, I forget. Oh, what's that down here? A dollar.
Mamma Mia, here I go again. My, how can I resist you? Mamma Mia, there's a show again. My, just how much I miss you. Yes, I can get a Wonka bargain. Chocolate that was so far. I will never let you go, Mamma Mia. Now I really know, Mama. I cannot let you go.
I was so in that moment. I left my body.
Yeah, you were like,
I was no longer like, on Wonka Watch.
I want you guys to understand, she was like doing a full performance. She was holding up fake money. She went cross-eyed when she held it in front of her face. And she was like looking at things that were like, she was looking at like the storefront. I was like, whoa, I was so enraptured. It was great.
That was my audition to play Charlie. In
yeah, I play Wonka, you play Charlie. That would be fucking scary. Oh, that's scary.
They've always done Wonka as the older person and Charlie as the kid. But what if we
really weird 18-year-old and Charlie was just this weird 28, 27?
How old are you? 27. You ask, how do we differentiate this Wonka from all the others? What makes yours so special, kid?
This one, Wonka's 18 and it doesn't really make any sense, but he actually took the Wonka bite, and that's something we reveal in Act 2. Oh God. Okay. So Charlie gets his golden ticket. A beautiful song all happens during Mamma Mia. We make it into the factory. We kind of breeze over the whole opening. I didn't even try to do pure imagination. I gave up. I didn't feel like doing it. I don't really have Oompa Loompa songs for this per se, but I decided to pick a song that kind of evoked that vibe because I haven't decided. I think if I was making a Wonka Jukebox musical, I might take the original take that Roald Dahl had of like, they're just factory workers who are like way too into Wonka. That's probably what I would do, honestly. Yeah. But I wanted to kind of evoke that with this song that has always haunted me, that I always think of, the way I would describe it is a haunted Wiggles safari. All right. That's what I would say about this song. And for Augustus Gloops's death, I picked the song Hot Wax by King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard, a personal favorite band of mine. And you would need to change the song to be something about chocolate, like hot chocolate. Or hot chalk. It doesn't really work. But I was also thinking about this more from an orchestral scoring perspective. I don't think Elaine's really recovered from the dark wiggle safari that I said earlier. But you'll see what I mean when you play it.
You've been spot on. I don't doubt.
This song sounds wet.
Ew, you're right.
All right, if you skip to about 1 minute and 3 seconds in, you'll get to the second singer. This is why I picked this song.
The B-52s came and they said hello.
I know.
I hate how good it is in terms of what you described it as, like, if there was Oompa Loompa or something like that. The voices sound a lot like 2005 Oompa Loompa voices, which I appreciate. And it kind of has, I don't know why that one has unsettled me the most so far.
Yeah, it's a strange one.
But that's what you need in a Wonka musical, though. So like that should happen.
I wanted to embrace the 1970s psych rock a little bit. I mean, this isn't from the 70s, but King Gizzard are super inspired by that stuff. I'm going to try not to go on to like one of Felicia's classic autism hyper interest rants. But so that's what I feel about the Augustus scene. I just wanted a song that was kind of inspired by the Oompa Loompa songs, you know, keep that vibe going, but without really.
Yeah.
Committing to that theme. So this was the last addition to my playlist, which is our next song coming up, which I think might be my favorite thing I picked and I think is my most inspired choice. So I wanted a song for the boat scene. You know, the scene where Gene Wilder goes, I'm fucking crazy, basically on the boat, and everyone freaks out about it. And I considered a lot of different options. I was originally looking at like some Black MIDI music and like some, you know, some other songs. But I was like, I kind of want to throw some Death Grips in here. I feel like, one, it would freak Elaine the fuck out. And two, I just feel like there's a place for it. And I heard this song and I said, yes, 100%. We found it. We found it, ladies and gentlemen. This is the boat scene. And oh, I described this song in my notes here as like you're falling down a well in a funhouse with 8 pianos also falling with you. And there is a lyric where one guy just yells, I'm going to kill somebody really loud. And that's why I picked it. I was like, I don't know. And then I heard one guy go, I'm going to kill somebody. And then a bunch of people just screaming in the background. And I said, oh, we've got it. We've got it, ladies and gents. So... you know, check out the fear.
What is happening? It's like R&B, but like the jazz band went to the bar and they're really drunk now, and Jay-Z happened to come across them and he's also drunk and he's like, let's do it, guys. But then literally, like, one of them's had too much to drink and is ready to commit murder.
Okay. I'm done. I have reset as a human being after that experience. What the fuck did I just I'm playing the first 6 seconds. Like, what the fuck did you just play? What the flying fuck is this? When did you want this to play again?
During the boat scene.
Okay.
It's right, right?
It's right. I'll let you have this one. I'll let you have that one.
Every time he says I'm going to kill somebody in the beginning, it's so funny.
Really, verbatim, we need that one going to be like, I'm going to kill somebody. It's like, the fuck? As you enter this dark tunnel with a madman and you're like, shit, he is.
And you just hear a guy in the background go, the fear. And then Wonka goes, I'm going to kill somebody. It's so perfect.
My heart is beating at a different tempo than it was before. Tell me what's next.
I'm gonna kill somebody.
I'm gonna kill somebody.
So I went for Violet Beauregard, and as the known Violet Beauregard apologist, I had to give her quite the number. So I decided to pull out
Fiona Apple.
Oh, Fiona Apple. I have heard of her. That's exciting because pure imagination for the Chipotle commercial, and not for Wonka, but for Chipotle is how I know about that because I fucking love Chipotle.
Fiona Apple, she's like my Taylor Swift. Like, you know how people are like very intense about how they feel about Taylor Swift? And I'm like, I don't get it. No one just makes me feel that way. And then I listen to Fiona Apple and I go, you know what? I stand corrected. My apologies. This song captures the defiantness that I see in Violet Beauregard. She has this potential that's very rough. This isn't really a funny choice. It's just, I really like the song and I really like Violet Beauregard.
You're very passionate about it. I want to note that the album this is off of is called Fetch the Bolt Cutters.
Yes.
Which is a phrase I would like to casually start using. I'm not sure how yet, but add that to the list of things I just want to say.
I used to march down the windy, windy sidewalk, slapping my leg with the riding crop, thinking it made me come off so tough. I didn't smile.
I see it.
It's unhinged enough to fit in with the rest of the music.
The piano man for this musical will be fucking playing for
He's
going to
be so tired.
You're going to need like carpal tunnel surgery after this. Like, it's going to be a lot. This is good.
Yeah, it's a really good song.
I see it. This is a very, I see what you mean also. It's like, it still has the,
it has this aggression,
but with heart in it. Yeah.
It fits with the chaos of earlier.
If you don't have a Veruca Salt song, I have one.
Oh, I have one too. Don't worry.
Oh, good. Okay.
Before I get into my whole thing, Elaine, what do you think would be a good song for Veruca? Because I'd love to hear it.
Lyric-wise, does it make sense? Probably not. Sonically, would it make sense with what's going on now? No. But I don't know if you know this about me, Felicia.
Yeah.
I'm into Russian history. I don't know if you know this.
I never knew.
I'm fascinated by Anastasia. And there's an Anastasia musical.
Oh, so you're going to pick a song from another musical. That's a bold pick for a jukebox.
Why hasn't anyone done a jukebox musical that's songs from other musicals?
We're revolutionizing.
Anyway, it would be Land of Yesterday, which is basically the Russian elite.
When the Russian Revolution happened, all of the fancy nobles ran away to France because nobles spoke French in Russia because that was their weird thing. So they had like a hot connection. And so they ran away to France. Mm-hmm. And like
this whole scenario is basically this Russian club. And they're like, well, we're not dead now, but we're in France now. And it's kind of whiny about like the land of yesterday. Like, remember when we were fancy people and now we're just like middle class French people. And it just seems like it would really fit the vibe.
Let us not be sad. The night's young and Russians are mad, so let's live in the land of yesterday, live in the grand imperial heyday.
So as a contrast to that, what I've picked is Charge It off of Tim Curry's classic 1979 album Fearless. I am obsessed with this album. I've talked about it on every first date I've been on. I listened to it for days straight. None of my friends like it, and it would always get pissed when I would talk about it. I had a theory for a while that this album was Tim Curry acting in self-destruction, like he hated the songs and was actively trying to ruin them, but it turns out that he wrote them, and that really, really made me get so confused. And he keeps doing a lot of different accents. There's like one song where he goes about four different accents. There's one song called Do the Rock where he sings entirely with an Italian accent. There's another song called, it's something about, I think it's Paradise Garage, and he sings as if he's from New Jersey for a verse. It's really weird.
So these are, it's not like Barbara Streisand best hits when it's like her singing famous musicals she was in. These are all like Tim Curry is like, I'm just going to sing.
They're either
songs.
Covers or Tim Curry's original. And this song is an original song called Charge It. It is the stupidest song I've ever heard in my life, which is about Tim Curry committing credit card fraud. And I just thought, Veruca Salt, there's so much. I am rich. Don't question me in this song. I know every lyric to this song by heart, and I do an impression of it all the time. But he says, you say you won't accept my Visa or American Express, and the computer is suspicious because I've got no fixed address. Lady, that's a valid document. Check out the way I'm dressed. That's part of the lyrics. And then he threatens violence upon the store worker by saying, there's a driver in my car outside who's easily distressed. And lady, when he's through with you, he's going to leave your face a mess. this episode may or may not have been a vehicle for me to talk about this album. And then there's a part at the end of the song that I'm obsessed with that he's just talking about his Spanish tailor, where he says, "I don't carry green. It's just it makes such a bulge in the pocket. Oh, you like what? The suit? There's something in the piping in the back. I wanted to have it changed. But my Spanish tailor didn't fly in last week. You know him? He's called Manuel. But he always makes the pockets that if you put money in it, it looks so ugly."
What?
I've listened to this song so many times, Elaine.
Felicia, I feel like I'm physically having a panic attack. Like, mentally, we're okay. But, like, the physical, I'm sweaty.
I don't know if it's the dress. Lady, that's a valid document. Check out the way I'm dressed.
You know the way I'm feeling now, like Decolonic Decadent. Paradise law for a capital gain. Traded for a ticket on a great B train. I can amortize the cost with a minimum.
This song, genuinely, it's so good. It's awful, but it's so good.
I hate that I like this.
Okay, well, that was an experience.
He also, there's a part where he says to the cashier, he says, "Do you even read? Are you literate, babe?"
Do you even read?
And then he goes, "Are you numerate, babe?" And then later he goes, "I need to talk to the manager. There's a serious problem in personnel with this establishment." And then he goes, "Oh, you can't be the manager." <It's>
That changed my life, but I don't know if for the better.
Yeah, it's a good song.
But it's where we are. I like it.
This was a predictable choice. We're getting to Mike TV, and I talked a lot about how I wanted a Beastie Boys Mike TV moment. So I was like, I don't know what the right song was, and I landed on What You Want. So What You Want. There's no way to say the title of that song was sounding normal. The major thing of the song is, where'd you get your information from, huh? Which really, Mike TV constantly questions Wonka, and that's kind of why I went up to this. Also, one of the members of the Beastie Boys is named Mike D., so changing that to Mike T is so easy.
Okay.
I mean, there's three of them on here, but it could all be Mike TV. So this song is also just genuinely very good. So
also, I feel like a good musical vibe. It's kind of like when they had Nick Jonas pop in Les Mis just yes. to like spice it up. They had Cody Simpson in for
Anastasia. You know who's playing it? It's Kieran Culkin.
I'm just going to hit play now. Remember how, like, in our first episode, it took us, like, halfway through until it was, like, who's Roald Dahl?
Yeah.
I've never actively listened to the Beastie Boys. I don't know anything about them. So I just totally guess-anded the first time we talked about it, and I still enjoyed it. But, like, I feel like I came off like I knew a lot about the Beastie Boys, and I would just like to be really honest and vulnerable right now and say I know jack shit about the Beastie Boys.
Do you see what I mean when I say he has big Beastie Boys energy, though?
Oh, my God. Yes, though.
They're,
yeah.
like, kind of annoying.
It's like rock rap kind of vibe.
Yeah, that's exactly what the Beastie Boys
which
are.
Is totally him. And I see now, way better than the song they tried to do in the Broadway musical.
This that's is what he should have been. He's not a metalhead. He's a Beastie Boys head. So now that you understand that, I feel good. I feel like we've learned something. I almost didn't even include the Beastie Boys because I thought I'd made the point too much. But I'm glad I put it in because it turned out you were just completely pretending the whole time. So
I learned a lot. I wasn't pretending. I was just like going uh-huh. along with it.
Well, it really shows how much I will keep myself going if no one questions it.
Oh my gosh, we only have two songs left.
Oh, two songs left, and one of them is just the credit music. So basically, it's only one because, of course, I included credit music because I'm Felicia. And I don't know how to be normal about things. So final song of the musical, this is kind of our The View from Up Here. If this takes in the role of where it was in the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory musical, this is our Wonka hands the factory over to Charlie. And I picked the song Hand It Over by MGMT. Wow. Is it a little on the nose? Yes. But I think lyrically, this is the most on point song. Have I cried to this song? Maybe. So this song, I'll give you some of the lyrics. It says, "But the doors won't shut until there's nothing left to use. Someone's taken over, threw it away, but now I say it's time to hand it over." It's kind of a very somber, bittersweet song that I think works very well in this moment.
This is the third song you've put on this playlist that has a clown on the album art. Just want that noted.
Same old trick to play the hand.
think, easy listening song on this playlist. Everything else is kind of attacking you a little bit. It's kind of, it's coming very combative. Mm-hmm. And this song is more reflective. It takes a step back. And yeah. to not have it end on that note, I wanted to include the credits music of a song that I just think is one of the best songs ever written and deserves more appreciation, which is Cool in the Pool by Holger Tuke. And it's 5 minutes of pure chaos. And I think it's perfect to end off the Wonka Jukebox musical.
Is that a bagpipe or a sitar? What is happening?
I don't know what it is.
If you want to, like, if you're going to be wrong all the way is the theme also of Wonka the Jukebox musical.
Yeah.
And that song. Is it even about Cool in the Pool? Like, I know you said lyrics at me, but, like, I didn't digest any. Like, what?
I don't think I said any lyrics to you, but this one, the lyrics of this one are, I can recite them from memory. Let's get hot on the dancing spot. So hot. Is it hot? Wow. Cool, then. Now let's get cool in the pool. Let's get cool. Oh, let's get cool in the pool. Let's get cool. Wow. And those are all the lyrics of the song. There's nothing else. It's more of a tone piece, as I said, once again. I just think that song deserves more appreciation.
Personally. I understand. And I get it.
Thank you.
I get you. I don't know.
How do you feel, Elaine? How do you feel after this? I feel like I've put okay. you on a journey.
I like my arms are tingling and I don't know what that's like. I feel like I clenched every muscle in my body without realizing it. I did go on an emotional roller coaster. This was way better than I thought it would be. Not that it would have been bad. I just more in a feeling out of body experience chaos that I know you have in your back pocket. This really is beautiful and I think it hits hard. My favorites are Excuse Me.
Thank
I love clearly Mamma Mia, The Fear, Charge It, which I like. I hate that that's a thing. I don't want to say Cool in the Pool just out of self-respect, but sure. But I like Everyone Fit.
Thank you.
Damn.
I put a lot of work into this playlist. I like revised this over like 2 weeks. I'd come back to it every few days and move things around. Like I put way too much work into this. It's embarrassing.
It was
so
good.
That's my Wonka Jukebox musical. Another long-standing topic from our topic dump. Checked off. Bleep it. And that's how you do a musical, ladies and gents. That's what I say, the Broadway producer. Make them go fucking crazy. Make them lose their goddamn minds. Make them shiver in their seats. Make the jazz band have a heat stroke. That's how you musical.
I'm gonna say it, kid. I doubted you from the start. But now, I think we got a possibility. I think we got a choice.
Goodness, that's the words I've been wanting to hear you say.
Now what I'm gonna do.
Why are our Broadway producers from Alabama?
I don't know. Anybody can make it now. The only stipulation I have is that Willy Wonka is going to be played by a child, and that child is a Chips Ahoy cookie.
Oh, sure. I think we've... Okay, Elaine, why is the Chips Ahoy cookie a child when it's trying to seduce a woman?
Oh, scrap that. Hold on. Wait, strike that. Reverse it. No, Willy Wonka separately will just be played by a chocolate chip cookie that sings about how sexy it is.
So the chips are
there we
cookie.
Go. Yes.
So I'm
everyone's
sorry, sir,
cookies.
I
hear
think,
me out.
I think I may be having to take this business elsewhere because that cookie
good
is the scariest thing I've
luck.
Ever seen in my life.
You're about to get a bunch of NYU theater kids trying to make it big doing a shit show
Timothy
on your Chalamet, little...
Timothy, how'd you get into my office?
I've been here all the time. It was me.
What a method actor.
I just like really think that this would be pretty cool as a musical, and I guess I'm down. I don't know.
I didn't know you were such a Chips Ahoy fan, Timothy.
You know what me? I go, ahoy, ahoy, Chips Ahoy. And then I just gobble them up.
Famously, that is your catchphrase, Timothy Chalamet.
Yep. I'm actually starring in a very historical drama about the making of Chips Ahoy.
I remember when you lost that Oscar and I could hear the cries of ahoy, ahoy across the Oscar stadium, which I was there at, because aside from being a Broadway producer, I'm also a movie producer. Okay. We need to stop this bit.
Anyway,
Elaine, what are your predictions about the Wonka movie? We have to get back to Miss Bonbon. We have to talk about Miss Bonbon.
Miss frickin' Bonbon. My prediction is that Miss Bonbon, ooh, I already want to go against this.
I think she's, is she evil or is she good? Let me flip my chapstick.
She's good. I think she's good. I do think she's good. I'm going to like lean away from how I normally feel about everything.
Yeah.
Miss Bonbon,
you kind of assume the worst of people. Okay. What's your prediction? That she's good?
Yeah. Look, we talked about getting way too specific, right? So I'm going real big fucking broad on this one. She's okay. Good.
I'm going to say she's a local candy store owner. And like a side character, like those side characters in Paddington that he helps out. You know how they're like all these people who he gets mm-hmm. little tips and tricks from that help him at the end of the movie. I think Wonka's going to have a similar thing where like he and this lady enter into a deal. Maybe they'll have a friendly rivalry, but not one that's actually any big deal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Anyway, thank you for listening to this episode of Wonka Watch. If you have your own suggestions for Wonka Jukebox musical or want to yell at me about my choices, you can email us at wonkarapture@gmail.com. We are catching up on emails currently. You know, the Wonka Well doesn't always have the best reception. So sometimes it takes us a little bit of time to get there, but we are getting around to the emails. So thank you everyone who has listened and supported us. If you want to support us more, you can go to buymeacoffee.com/WonkaWatch. We actually got our first supporter. It was anonymous, Yay! But whoever it was, we thank you immensely. That is,
we love
like,
you.
The other money was from my grandparents, who were very nice to me. And the other $5 was me making sure it worked. So we have our first, like, non-known contribution, and it made us feel very nice and happy. So we're glad that, like, you know, we appreciate it
right
a lot.
Back into the podcast. Say,
was right back into paying for that Life magazine Elaine has never read about Wonka.
Woo! Don't get me started.
With Wonka Mad Libs. Getting this podcast out of the green, slow, out of the red, slowly. Every day, crawling it up on the edges. It goes into the black, and then one of us buys a container of creamer, and we're back in the red again.
Dude, I go to every fucking grocery store and I try to see if they have the goddamn Whipple Scrumptious Creamer.
And they texted it and showed me a photo of it. And I'm like, it's fucking real. Where is it? I can't
Where is
find
it?
This
and everyone,
stupid creamer.
Every time I'm there, my friends are like, what are you doing? Because I don't drink coffee. And they're like, what the fuck? I'm like, I
need to know if it's here.
But if you want to know if we find it immediately, the best way would be to follow us on Instagram and TikTok at Wonka Watch. What? That's insane. Oh my gosh. Golly geez. Wow, I'm sweaty, and there's some cake batter. Hey, Felicia, it doesn't really matter. That was not a song. That wasn't worth it. I'm sorry. I'm really sorry. How about you do it? I'm done.
And you know, and it wasn't even the catchphrase. We always say it's not that important.
Oh, shit.
Oh, shit. I was like, why did that feel so weird?
Oh, shit. Ew. It felt weird.
I guess... at the end of the day.
Well, we can tell it's really not that important because you forgot the fucking catchphrase.
It's not that important. What the it's fuck is this important. Podcast even called? I don't know. What are we talking about? I don't know half the time, clearly.
It's not that important.
May you enjoy your panic attacks, everybody. Bye!
I'm gonna kill somebody.